Good afternoon, everyone. It gives me immense pleasure to extend a very warm welcome to all on behalf of the Commerce Association, Department of Commerce, Shahid Bhagat Singh College. We have clubbed us together on a digital platform for a second webinar by the on discovering resources using Scopus Citation Analysis Tool Part 2. The Commerce Association extends heartiest welcome to our Honorable Principal, Dr. Anil Sardana, Teacher in Charge, Dr. Kalpana Gupta, our Convener and Session Moderator, Ms. Aarti Saini, and our very eminent speaker, Dr. Pooja Anand Gulati. Before we begin with the webinar, we would like to request our Honorable Principal, Sir, Dr. Anil Sardana, to share his vision.
Your webinar has been very successful.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for giving me this opportunity, sir.
Yes. And that is why we had the version 2 and similar things done by Dr. Poonam Sharma also. And she's here. I can see her name.
Yes.
And she has started and taken the initiative by other departments, Department of Haritkram and Commerce Department under the leadership of Dr. Gupta. And Aarti has very rightly taken the initiative of starting this initiative will go a long way because I believe that rest in sharing the knowledge and acquiring the knowledge also through webinars, because the physical challenges, the challenges of distances will be taken care by, because it is not necessary that the knowledge you need to have, to get the knowledge you need to have the person in the stage, and the stage is beautified and thousands and lakhs of rupees are spent. Rather, I believe that the knowledge travels from one place to another place only on the intent of the person who is a seeker, who wants to seek the knowledge and who wants to upgrade himself or herself. I compliment all the participants who have come and had come on that day also, because I believe that the time has come when this definitely prevail, publish or perish. And nobody wants to perish. If you want to publish, you have to publish a good quality, in good quality journals and a good quality material, because only the quality will sustain. All other things will get churned out. And I'm happy that in our college, we have people working in quality work. If I start naming, there will be many. So I choose not to name them, but I'm definitely happy. And now there should be a kind of healthy competition among the producers and creators of material so that it can be shared with the world at large. The time has come when the rating of the institution is judged by all these performances and all these contributions. Gulati also to write down whatever she has explained in the last webinar and what she is going to talk about today, and plus supplement it and create a kind of small, very small ebook, and that will be beneficial for the world at large. Whatever the expenses will come, I offered last time also. That's not a big thing. And with these words, I do not want to come in between. I compliment Aarti. Aarti has really done remarkable job, and a lot more we are expecting from you, Aarti, and the collaboration with the new teacher in charge, as well as under the leadership of present teacher in charge, Dr. Kalpana Gupta. I just wish to share with you that our college is a very good college in terms of, following the university. We have finished our internal assessment work. Our examination forms have been submitted, 99%. Now we are going to start with the profile building of students. It's a different kind of program which we are working on that. I will need the help of different teacher in charges as well as teachers. Principle is the same which I said 1 year before, student connect program. But I didn't know that Corona will make it compulsory for us to do that. So without speaking much about other things, I once again congratulate Dr. Poonam Gulati, and it's a good initiative. And I look forward to more. It's not necessary that Anyone can come forward. Ankita can start a webinar series. Ila can start. Chandni can start. Or anybody can start. We have had something, unfortunate in the department. There is some colleagues as fathers has expired because of Corona. We are sad because of that. I insist, but at the same time, we continue with our this good work, and God will rest them him in peace. So I once again do not come in between. Please carry on, and my compliments and my best wishes to all and all the people who are giving the knowledge to the world at large. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, sir, for your kind words. I would now like to request our esteemed teacher in charge, Dr. Kalpana Gupta, to address the gathering.
Hello. Principal Dr. Anil Sadana, the speaker of the today, Dr. Pooja Anand Gulati, Ms. Arti Saini, the convener of the Commerce Association, and my dear friends, I welcome you all to the webinar on Discovering Resources Using Scopus Citation Analysis Tool Part 2. The Part 1 was held on 27th of May by Dr. Pooja Anand Gulati, and that part was appreciated by all very much. And because of that, we are continuing with the second part, and I think it will also be very informative and useful to all of you. So I welcome Dr. Pooja Anand Gulati and hand over the mic to her. Thank you.
Thank you so much, ma'am, for your kind words. Let me now introduce you all to our speaker, Dr. Pooja Anand Gulati. Dr. Pooja, faculty, Shahid Bhagat Singh College, is a doctorate holder in library and information science. She has an experience of 20 years working with highly esteemed and regarded institutions such as UNICEF, British Council, DELNET. Along with being responsible for successful implementation of library automation and modernization project of college library, she is also credited with organizing a national level seminar on the theme Building Digital India. Also, she is strongly admired for initiating the digital information management course under the aegis of Center for Skill Development of the College. Before we log in, I request you all to refrain from using microphone and video during the webinar. Also note that we will be having a question and answer session after the lecture. Please share your queries in chat box. I would now request Dr. Pooja Anand Gulati to share her insights on the topic.
Am I audible to all of you? Dhruv, please let me know. Am I audible?
Yes, ma'am. You're audible.
Okay. Very good afternoon to all of you. Let me begin by expressing my sincere gratitude for giving me this opportunity again to interact and further discuss about this pertinent resource discovery and impact discovery tool that is Scopus. I'm really thankful to our principal, Dr. Anil Sardana, commerce in charge, Dr. Kalpana Gupta, and my dear friend who is commerce association convener, Ms. Arti Saini, for providing me this platform again. It is quite encouraging for me. So with this feeling of gratitude, please permit me to start my today's session. I'll be presenting my PPT and would be asking you whether it is. The text of the PPT is legible to all of you? Dhruv, is it legible?
No, ma'am, we cannot see your screen.
Okay, let me do that. Just give me a moment. Let me be comfortable with it. Let me start my screen sharing. Are you able to see my desktop?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. And now you are able to see my PPT better?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Okay, hope all of you are doing well. Now let me start with my presentation.
Could you please unmute yourself?
Am I audible, please?
Yes, please, sir.
Okay, good afternoon, everyone. Hope all of you are doing fine. And once again, a big thanks to all the participants for providing me this platform again. I'm really feeling honored. It's a great encouragement for me. Thanks for giving this kind of encouragement to me. With this feeling of gratitude, please let me begin my today's presentation. What we were discussing last time. Last time we were discussing that we are living in the realm of knowledge economy, which is purely research driven. And how does research begin? Research basically starts with studying of related literature. And when we are saying that it starts with studying of related literature, that process starts with discovering and finding the related literature. So when we are trying to find out the related literature, we are deeply concerned about the quality of that related literature. So there are various parameters on the basis of which the quality of literature is being measured. One of the parameters which we have been talking and listening for so long is peer-reviewed literature. What is this peer-reviewed literature? Peer-reviewed is a fine line between information and knowledge. Once a set of information is being reviewed by experts in that particular field, that information becomes peer-reviewed and it is considered qualitatively better than the regular kind of literature. So this is one of the parameters which is being used to measure the quality of literature. That is why everyone is emphasizing so much on peer-reviewed literature. There are many other parameters like who is the producer of this literature? Who is publishing that literature? Which institution or funding body is providing fund to this literature? So all these factors are assessing the quality of literature. So why we are discussing this tool? We are discussing this tool because it has incorporated all these indexes, many metrics are being devised by universities and by experts to measure the quality of literature on the basis of these various parameters, which I have been telling about. The various parameters are on the basis of producer of the content, that is author, on the producers or on the basis of parameter who is publishing that is publisher, or which institution is affiliating that study, that is what is the scholarly output of that institution. So there are parameters which are being devised by various universities, and that those parameters are being incorporated in this database. So that is a single access database, single access point with the help of which any researcher could pursue his actual research. And this pre-research period is the most important period. Why I'm saying that it is the most important period? Because it is the foundationing process for carrying out your actual research. Once your foundation is sound, then you'll be able to build your building very well. So that is why we have planned, we were discussing a few days back, Aarti and I, what should we do? How should we plan our series? That is why we have planned our series in a way that in first phase, we'll be deciding upon this pre-research things. What are the pre-research requirements and what are the pertinent tools which can be used to equip us with quality resources, and how can we manage these resources with the help of reference management? So these tools we'll be learning in our first phase, and in our second series we'll be learning about there are some guidelines. We have to work within those guidelines. There are some guidelines which are being laid down by UGC so that to protect us from falling into trap of any academic misconduct. We should do our work very carefully so that no plagiarism should occur unintentionally on our part. So in second session, we'll be discussing about that. And in third series, we'll be discussing about after learning, okay, how should I collect material for conducting my actual research? What should I do in my pre-research period? Okay, now I know these are the guidelines laid down by UGC. I should work within the ambit of these guidelines. And finally, we'll be learning how to translate all these learnings into an effective manuscript, which we'll be finally submitting to a publisher for getting it published. So in that third series, we'll be learning how to choose an effective title, what are the different parts of a manuscript, starting from introduction till the discussion part. How to write an introduction, abstract, what are the methodologies, how should we portray our methodology in the paper, how should we discuss our results and present our results, and finally, how should we conclude our paper by discussing it. So, and at the end of the paper, we are always producing references and bibliographies, and the management of those things we'll be learning in this pre-session session. So this way, I and Aarti have planned that this way we'll be giving a complete package to our young researchers to carry out their actual research in a meticulous manner, in a planned manner. So with this brief background, let me just... Okay. Now I have been telling you from the last session that these qualitative measures, these qualitative indexes, metrics are very, very important. Why I'm saying this, our principal was also mentioning this, because they play a major part in determining the rank of your institution. Like recently, this QS World Top Universities ranking has come in June only, on 5th of June, this ranking has come. And this ranking is based on these six parameters. You can read them. These are the six parameters on the basis of which the top universities are being ranked. And see, point number four, what does it say? Point number four says, citations per faculty, it has got 20% weightage. It means 20% of your ranking depends upon your research output. And research output should be qualitative. Then only it will be able to produce citations. Okay. And then over here in red, I have written that 18 million recorded publications and 138 million recorded citations were considered before giving ranks to topmost institutions of the world. And if we'll equate them, what are the parallel institutions in India which are ranking Indian bodies? The parallel institutions in India which are ranking Indian higher educational institutions are NAC and NIRF, National Institute of Ranking, NIRF. It has also come out with its ranking recently only, and its ranking, I suppose, JNU is the topmost university. So, and now you will be surprised to know that NIRF gives 33% weightage, 33% weightage to research output. Though this top body, which is a British company, which is bringing out this publication every year, which would tell you which universities are topmost in across the world, this is just giving 20%. But our own affiliation, our own ranking body, NIRF, is giving 33% importance. That is why all educational institutions across the world are emphasizing on the quality of literature, and they are emphasizing their faculty members to contribute qualitative research so that it should attract good number of citations, it should get published in good journals, and you should be able to gather funding from prominent institutions in whatever area you are pursuing your research. So this slide is just to give you an overview how important these metrics and these. Okay, I'm sorry with the while handling my PC, sometimes I am missing. Okay, then these are the universities which are being ranked. These are the Indian universities. So it's a sorry state that India is not able to grab even the top 100 positions across the world. Are institutions of national importance, these IITs, IIMs, and NITs. These are considered, these are termed as institutions of national importance. These institutions are of national importance are saving our face, as IIT Bombay has secured 172nd position in this 2021 global ranking, followed by some of the IITs, and then Indian Institute of Science, Bangalore. And our Delhi University has scored rank 474th globally. And it is, Delhi University is number 7 in India. Okay. This is just to give you an idea that these metrics play an important role. So I have been mentioning this again and again, that this is the single tool on which most of the researchers are relying. And there is a parallel tool. There are just two tools which are widely being accepted for retrieving these kinds of metrics. And these two tools are Scopus and Web of Science. And we are giving weightage to focus because of this wider coverage, and that too in the field of social sciences. So these are the seven features which we discussed. We'll quickly run through them because we had covered them in our last session in detail. So just let us quickly run through them. What are the main features and functionalities of literature, Scopus? First, it would help us to explore the existing pool of information which is there in the academia, in the research output pool. And further, it would help us to analyze that result on the basis of seven parameters which we studied last time. And we'll be able to analyze those as search results on the basis of seven parameters. We'll be able to translate those results with the, into tables and charts, and we can reproduce those tables and charts in our literature survey while writing our literature survey in our article. So this is the primary function which we'll be able to do with the help of Scopus. Then we'll be also be able, if I'm pursuing research on a topic, I will also be able to know what are the topmost funding bodies who are giving fund for promoting research project on this specific topic. So this is the second function. Third function, we'll be able to collaborate with prominent authors publishing the most in our stream, and we'll be able to collaborate with them. And then a research impact, as I have been telling you, that we'll be able to measure the research impact of journals, authors, even for the articles and even for the institutions with the help of the indexes which are being incorporated in Scopus. And today we'll be discussing those indexes in detail. Last time I just mentioned them superficially. There are two indexes I mentioned, H-index and impact factor. But there are some refined versions of these indexes which are being incorporated in Scopus. Today we'll learn about them and we'll see how does they make a difference when we are using them. And then yes, one of the important thing which we can do with the help of the Scopus tool is that we can look at what are the active research areas. Active research areas means, like these days, coronavirus. This is the one of the most active research area, which people are running after it, and they are trying to find out a solution for this problem, which we people are facing across the world. So, and a few days back, what was the buzz topic? What was the active research area? I think among diseases, it was cancer. Now, coronavirus has surpassed cancer also. And if I'll talk about sectors, which sector was well-known and sought-after sector? Information technology, followed by information and communication technologies. And now these days, even artificial intelligence, people are running after artificial intelligence. So these kind of areas, which are sought-after areas, they are being called active research areas. So when you will monitor the global research trends, you will get to know, okay, these are the active areas where a lot of research is happening. Okay, and then fifth factor is discover research performance of researchers with the help of citations and H-index. With this, I have already covered. And then you'll be able to identify journals, you'll be able to identify prominent institutions, you'll be able to see which institution is contributing the most in which subject area. So, having said that, there is a small limitation about this Scopus citation analysis tool. What is that? This is a purely abstract and citation database. It does not provide link to full text articles, but it gives you directions. It gives you directions that if you want to access the full text, this is the source, from here you can access. And since it is not an individual subscription database, it's always a institute has to subscribe it. So most of the institutions are not subscribing to a single database. Like, if I am working in Delhi University, if I'll be accessing it, so it will direct me. You go to ProQuest, you go to Science Direct, you go to Springer to access the full text of this article. So it is quite possible that my university must be subscribing to those databases only. So accessing the full text of articles is not a problem. And having said that, when we are in our pre-research period, we are more interested in scanning the literature, we'll filter out the relevant ones, and then we'll be looking for complete full text things. Because it is not practically feasible if 7,500 results have come, would it be possible for us to see full text of all the 7,500 documents simultaneously? No. Let us first see and judge with the help of citations and abstract and other things, other parameters where it is published, which are the relevant ones which I should pick for my research, and then we may look for the full text of that document. So this is a limitation. Sorry. Okay. And what is the agenda of today's session? Agenda is we'll be having a small demo of Scopus, and we'll be looking upon some of the factors which we could not discuss last time, but they are very important. Then I'll be discussing some indexes which are incorporated in Scopus, but I could not discuss last time. And then again, I'll give you a quick run through a demo of Scopus. And then finally, we'll be talking about Mendeley. What is Mendeley? Mendeley is known to us as a reference management tool, but it has got lot of other functions also. That also we'll be discussing, and that also I'll be giving a demo of that. And why this reference management is essential, and this is also a way to promote your research, that also we'll be discussing. So today we'll be I won't go into this, we have already covered this. Just to brush you up with this, the concept, I have kept this slide over here. We know what is Scopus, we know the coverage, and we also know that over here I would like to highlight. So whenever you are conducting your literature survey, you're always referring to journal articles, followed by conference articles, standards, patents, theses. And very little proportion of your literature comprises of books. Why is it so? It is because of this fact, because these journals and conference papers are the literature forms which are in primary form. They are producing content which is original in nature, which is original, primary, new. And these books are publishing, are replicating the information which is already being produced, original information in books. So we are not referring to books that much. That is why you might be observing that most of the databases are concentrating on journals only, because journals are primary sources of information, that way where the original thing has been produced, where whatever research has been taken, like conferences are taking place. Conferences also, we are discussing about the latest trends, latest aspects of that particular topic, and then presenting our papers. So these are first hand information. So we are always, when we are pursuing research, we are always inclined towards first hand information. Okay. And now I have highlighted the social sciences just to apprise you that social sciences has got the largest contribution, this subject in the Scopus database. Okay, now this tool, I have already mentioned that there are seven functions, and in these seven functions, these research impact is one of the most important factor. That is why these databases like Scopus and Web of Science are also being considered by ranking bodies like NAT and NIRF. And this thing I have already mentioned, that NIRF is giving 33% importance to research output of an institution. And why I have mentioned ORCID over here again. Last time also we mentioned, but last time when I was talking about ORCID, I was saying ki please keep your name consistent everywhere. If like my name is Dr. Pooja Anand Gulati, I should write it consistently Dr. Pooja Anand Gulati. I should not write as Dr. Pooja A. Gulati like this. I should not make variations. In the same manner, whenever you are writing your university's name, please write it in similar manner. Because it has been observed that Jamia Millia Islamia suffered its ranking because they were quoting their institution's name in various manners. Sometimes they were writing JMI, something Jamia Millia. So you should remain consistent with your writing thing. If I am writing Delhi University, so I should continue with it. But it is always advisable to write University of Delhi. So whenever you are writing your affiliation, be consistent in that also. And if you have published something and you cannot edit that, so it is advisable to create your ORCID, because once you'll create your ORCID, it would take care of your affiliation part also. And now these databases, whatever information they are indexing, they are giving an affiliation ID to each institution. Our institution, University of Delhi, even Shaheed Bhagat Singh College has got an ID. So whenever you're writing that, it would recognize it with the help of that ID. So this we have already discussed in detail. What new we'll be discussing today? See, last time we discussed impact factor. That is a generic index which is being used to measure the impact of a journal in a particular field of study. And how do we calculate that? We calculate that an impact factor is always being calculated for a period of 2 years. Okay, how do we do that? We will see how many articles are published in the preceding 2 years. We'll put that number of articles in denominator. Okay, and the number of citations those articles have attracted, we'll put that number in numerator. Let me show that. Okay, the number of articles that the journal has produced in the preceding 2 years, that number we'll put in denominator, and the number of citations it has attracted in the against those articles, we'll put that in numerator. When we'll divide that number, whatever number would come, that is the impact factor of journal that we have already studied. What prompted institutions and universities to devise other refined versions of impact factor? Why they are devising other forms of impact factor? Reason being, as we were discussing last time, that this generic impact factor is biased towards subjects. It's biased towards fast moving subjects, and it is not justifiable with the subjects which are moving at slow pace. And the examples are given in this slide, like mathematics, engineering, and social sciences are considered slow moving subjects because the pace at which the research takes place and accordingly the volume of research which is being generated in these subjects is less. When the volume is less, the citations would also be less. So you cannot compare the impact factor of a mathematics journal with the impact factor of a medicine journal. For instance, if a medicine journal has got an impact factor of 10, and if you are, and it is possible that that is not the best journal in medicine. If a medicine journal with impact factor 10 is there, you cannot say that this is one of the best because it has got the impact factor 10. Why I'm saying that? Because in medicine, the impact factor can go up to 23, 25, and in fact, even more. But in mathematics, the maximum number which a best journal can attain is 5. It means in mathematics, no journal can go beyond 5 impact factor. So can you say if I'm publishing in mathematics journal, which has got an impact factor 5, that is somewhere less than the medicine impact factor 10 or the highest impact factor? No, because the subjects are not comparable. So to overcome these biases, some refined versions of impact factors are being devised. So today we'll be learning them. For journals, there are 3 kinds of impact factors which are being devised by different institutions, and they are already there in Scopus. Whenever you are visiting the profile page of journal, you will see all these indexes, and that the profile page would let you know as per this index, this journal position is there. As per this index, this journal position is there, like that. Okay. So what are these research metrics? Which I was telling, for journals, 3 metrics are site score, source normalized per paper, and Scimago journal rank. Okay, and all these 5, 3 for journals, the 4th one is for author. When I'm saying it is for author, it doesn't mean that it's always used for authors only. You can calculate H index of your respective department. Like in our college, 8 departments are there. Every department can derive their H index. How they'll be doing that? They'll be jotting down the number of articles being produced by that department. Then against each document, they'll be writing like this: article number 1 produced by the Department of Commerce has got 20 citations. Article number 2 till the last, they'll write how many citations. Wherever the at least number of titles would be equal to the at least number of citations, that would be the H index of that respective department. So for H index, you need a set of documents. Then only you will be a set of documents and a set of citations against those documents. Then only you will be able to arrive at H index. And this is also incorporated in our Scopus. And then for articles, this also we did not discuss we could not discuss last time. That is for article, how you would be evaluating a particular article, whether it is impactful, whether I should pick it up and cite it in my document or not. There is an index for an article also. What is the name of that index? The name of that index is field-weighted citation index. Now we'll discuss these two, because H index we have already covered. I have given you a slight thing for H index. Apart from individuals, you can also calculate it for a respective department. Okay, now let us move to this. Cite score. Cite score is, as I have been telling you, all these three of them are improved versions, refined versions of the generic impact factor. What are the improvements which are being incorporated in these? The first one, cite score. It is more comprehensive. Like, the impact factor is always being calculated for journals, but it is not taking into account conference papers. Though I am telling you that conference papers are also original in nature, they are also of primary nature, they also contain very pertinent information, but how would you rate whether this conference paper is effective, impactful, whether I should pick it up or not? So cite score would take care of that. Cite score would enhance, would broaden your inclusion. Apart from journals, it would also include proceedings papers, conference proceedings papers. So you would be able to compare whether I should pick up this journal paper or whether I should pick up this conference paper. Which one is better? Because both of them would be carrying a index with them, a number indicating that which if the more the number, the greater the impact and quality of that paper. So this is the only difference. Then source normalized impact paper. I have been telling you that H index is also biased. H index of authors working in science field will be obviously higher than the authors working in social sciences, mathematics, and other slow humanities field. In the same way, impact factor we have been discussing, it is also biased towards fast moving subjects. So this factor, so this index, source normalized impact per paper, would take care of those biases. It would give weightage to the citations based on the subject, in which subject these citations are being attracted. So source normalized impact paper would overcome that drawback. Now, third one, Scimago journal rank. You just have to remember this thing, that this Scimago journal rank is related to the prestige or reputation of a journal. Or how would you, prestige or reputation of a journal means, it would take into account quantity as well as quality of the citations. Now, how you would say ki, whenever I will ask you ki whether this article is good or not, how would you rate it? So the only thing which immediately come to your mind with, okay, I'll assess it on the number of citations. If a particular article has attracted more citations as compared to the another article, it means the article having more number of citations is more impactful because more people have cited that. No, it is not necessary. Why? That is why this Scimago journal rank is taking into account number of citations as well as quality of citations. Because where that citation is being reproduced, like if a citation has appeared in a patent and a similar kind of citation has appeared in a regular literature piece of work, which citation would you consider better? I think I would consider the patent citation better, because this patent citation has led to the creation of that patent. And so quality of that citation is better. If a citation has been produced in a government publication, in an international body report, UN report, World Bank report, so I would give weightage to that citation more compared to a regular kind of citation. If a regular citation is there in any journal, and if a citation on a similar topic is there in an international body report, I would give more value to that citation. So on the basis of where it is cited, by whom it is cited, the quality of the citation is. If it is the same kind of citation is cited by an eminent person, Amartya Sen is citing that, so then you would obviously give more weightage to that. Okay, he's not a regular person, he's a prominent person. So if he is citing this reference, it must have got something relevant. So this is the way how we give importance to the quality of citations. So these three metrics, indexes, measures, all these are synonyms. These three measures are being used for journals, and they are, all of them are there in Scopus. This second measure is being developed by University of Leiden, Netherlands, and the third metric is developed by Scimago, Spain. Okay. Now, yes, journals we have covered. The three metrics are there in Scopus. I'll be demonstrating them through my live demo. And now we have come to the article part, which we could not discuss last time. And it is very, very important, because most of the time you are referring to documents and you really want to know whether this document is impactful, how good it is in its research area. So for that, this metric, this index is there. This is called field-weighted citation impact, and it is based on a number which is called global world average. And this number, whosoever has devised this index, they have kept this global world average number at 1. What does this 1 mean? This 1 means it's an average number. So whenever you are picking an article, if it's global world average is 1, it means it's an average article in that field when compared to the articles published in that field across the world. And if its number is more than 1, it means that article quality is above than average when it would be compared with other articles published in that stream across the world. Like I have given an example, if a particular article has FWCI 6, it means that article, that particular article has received 6 times more citations as compared to an ordinary article in that particular field. So if it means ki an ordinary article would be given number 1, and whatever, if your article is above ordinary and average article, then it must be scoring global world average more than 1. In that case, it would be rated in, it would be moving towards good, better, best. And below average, it means you really need to work upon that. You are still in poor or bad category. You need to at least climb up to average. So this is this index, and you don't have to worry about their calculations. You just want to worry about their importance, because their importance is contributing a lot. And you just want to know what are these metrics. You just want to understand them. You are not going to calculate them manually. These tools would be doing that on the basis of, again, I am quoting that, these tools would be doing that on the basis of the content being indexed by them. So it is quite possible that if Scopus is producing an index number, it might be some different from the number which is being produced by Web of Science, because the content coverage is different. But having said that, the content which is being covered by both these databases is highly qualitative. Reason being, they have got an entire committee of subject experts, which they are continuously evaluating the content which is being indexed in their databases. And whenever they are finding that the content is not fitting into the parameters, not qualifying the parameters which are being set for the inclusion of a particular article or particular information source, so they will disqualify that. No, now you are not qualified to get it indexed. So now, today I'll be showing you some of the journals are claiming that our journal is Scopus Index. So you please publish your article with us. Don't get into that trap. You first go to Scopus, check whether it is true, it is Scopus Index or not. And sometimes what happens, some journals manage to get their content included in Scopus and Web of Science, but after some time, they are not able to live up to the expectations of parameters which are being set by these databases, that these are the minimum parameters. If a literature source would qualify them, then only we'll index them, otherwise we'll disqualify them. So you just go and know whether it is still there or it has been disqualified, because it is a continuous process. They are doing it on a half yearly basis. Okay. I hope I am not rushing. So this we have already covered last time, and I am assuming that the participants are similar, are same. That is why I'm not further elaborating them. This though we have already covered in length last time. What is H index? And during my, this though is very, okay. This again, I would like to show you with the help of example, because last time there was a question, why Google Scholar cannot be used? Why you are advising Scopus H index only? See, Google Scholar index, which is being used for measuring the output of an author, is called I10 index. Okay. And you see, this is a prominent author. This person is a very prominent person in the field of chemistry. His name is C.N.R. Rao. Okay. He was with JNU. I don't know where presently he's associated with. So see, his Scopus H index is 133. See, because it belongs to a fast moving subject. He belongs to a fast moving subject. So his H index could go up to 133. And parallelly, if we are deriving I10 index from Google Scholar, which is a parallel thing to H index, it is 155. So that kind of difference can come if you will derive your I10 index from Google Scholar. So it is always advisable. Why is it doing so? Because Google Scholar is duplicating things. It is taking into account Google Books database also. Though whenever you are calculating H index, you are all the more excluding secondary sources of information. And I have already told you, these books are secondary source of information. They are just replicating the information which has already been generated by researchers and already been produced by researchers in journals and conference papers. So the H index is being calculated on the basis of primary literature. What is research actually? What is the meaning of research? What is the purpose of research? Purpose of research is that you need to add something new to the pool of knowledge. Unless and until you are not adding new dimension, something new to the pool of knowledge, you're not contributing anything. If you're just compiling, you're just collecting, okay, I am trying to study this problem and I have collected all the literature. I'm just compiling it and I'm not adding any new aspect. I'm not filling up the gap. I'm not looking at the ambiguities, gray area. So what I'm contributing? Irrespective of the kind of research, be it a small or a large one, be it in an experimentive subject like sciences, where you're experimenting and inventing something, or in social sciences, where you're not inventing something, but you are you are putting your efforts, time and mind into finding out a problem, causes. So you need to put something new to that problem, give a new dimension to that subject. That is research. No, you need to add. So Google Scholar is taking into account all those things, which is basically not research. Sometimes somebody, because he's a prominent author, some people are quoting him in their Twitter account. Some students might be pursuing their PhD under him. So they might be flaunting, hey, I did my PhD under so-and-so. So in that case, his name is appearing across the web many a times, but that is not his research. So research, if you really want to judge a person on the basis of actual research, so Scopus and Web of Science, these are the last time many of the questions were coming. That is why I have explained that with the help of an example. Now, this I have already covered, that there are two tools and there is a free tool also developed by Microsoft, publisher Parish. Okay, but again, it is not advisable unless and until if you're submitting something and that journal itself is asking, okay, you provide us your I10 index. Okay, if that journal itself is asking, you provide I10 index, because it is all the more possible that your I10 would be higher than your H index. But authenticity wise, if you really want to validate your work, H index. So the national ranking bodies are always considering H index. So last time I was also asked, can you please show us how would be able to access it? See, it is a subscription-based database. No individual subscription institutions are subscribing to it. And secondly, it's an IP-enabled database. So once you are in your college premises or university premises, you'll be able to access that. But because these days we are working from home, during this lockdown, all the universities have extended its remote access. For that, I just know about Delhi University. How is it doing that? So Delhi University's Central Library is sending an email to all of their faculty members and asking them to register with this website. Once you'll register with this DUE Library, informaticsglobal.com, and log in, and once you log in over there, they will give you they will provide you your login ID and password. And when you'll go to this website and you'll type your login ID, you'll be able to see the complete list of e-resources being subscribed by your particular university, that is University of Delhi. And then the resources list is being given over there in alphabetical order, and then you go to Scopus. This is the way how you will be able to access that. And this I'll be showing you through my live part. Now let us come to Mendeley. I think whatever new tools I have described about Scopus, everything I'll be showing you through my live demo. You don't have to worry about that. And I'll quickly run through the old things also. So because RT this time has been very liberal in giving me a good time slot, so I should not worry about time now. So now, this is a new concept. I really want you to pay attention on this. So I have been mentioning that Mendeley is known to us as a reference management tool, but it does many other functions. What are they? It is a kind of social networking platform. And you will be astonished to know that the kind of researchers which are registered with Mendeley, they are 9 million. It means 90 lakhs. 90 lakhs researchers, 9 million researchers across the world are registered with Mendeley, with whom you can collaborate. So it's an academic social network. We are subscribing to many networks. So it's an academic researchers network. Then this is a function of research reference management thing, that you will be able to organize your, and the beauty of this tool is that when earlier you were doing your literature search, you were supposed to keep all the documents in very safe manner. You were supposed to, and whenever you are citing them in your research paper, whenever you are producing reference list or bibliography list from them, you need to dig them out. Where I have kept them. And sometimes your computer is malfunctioning and you're not able to access them. You are saying, oh my God, I'm not able to access my computer. Hard disk has crashed. What should I do now? You don't have to worry about all these things, because whatever references you will add to this Mendeley will make a virtual library of that and would keep all those references on its cloud. So you don't have to worry about your hardware. Let it get crashed. You don't have to worry, because your references are safe and sound with the cloud system of Mendeley. And the second beauty is that once you'll click the sync button, so you will be able to access all the references which are saved and stored in your library from anywhere. Portability feature is there. Because if they are in the cloud, you don't have to carry your pen drive, or you don't have to carry your hard disk all the time. Okay, all my references are there, let me just carry them. No, you just sync them. If I'm sitting in University of Delhi, then also I'll be able to access them. If I'm sitting in Andaman and Nicobar Islands, and then also I'll be able to access them. So this is the digital dividend which we are deriving out of these advanced digital technologies. We are so fortunate that we are living in the era of digital technologies. Our senior researchers, they used to work hours and hours in libraries. They used to run from one library to another to get to fetch the literature out of the libraries. But in these days, this all is not required. Thanks to this digital dividend of digital technologies, everything is just a click away, and everything you can save on cloud. You don't have to worry about anything. And the third part, which you don't have to worry about with this Mendeley tool, is that many a times you have been asked by a particular journal that this is our citation style. Whenever you're writing your article, you are supposed to cite your references within the text in this form, and at the end of the document, whenever you are giving your list, you have to give the citations in this form. You don't have to worry about that. You just save the bibliographic details. Bibliographic details means the what is the title, who is the author, where it is published, on which page it is published, in which year it is published. These are bibliographic details. Or in layman manner, you may say that is the address of the document. Like my address is, I am living in Dwarka, and my professional address is, I am working with Shaheed Bhagat Singh College. If somebody would like to locate me, they'll either locate me at my professional address or at my personal address. So if somebody would like to locate the documents which are cited by you, how they would locate them? With the help of their address. And what is the address? The address is the bibliographic details. And there are standard forms which are being devised by different kinds of styles. You should write the address of your documents. Address is not a right word. I am just giving an example. The right word is bibliographic details, reference details. So those reference details have to be specified in a particular format, in a particular style. So you will be surprised to know that Mendeley has got more than 7,500 styles. More than 7,500 styles in which you can produce your references or bibliography, and at the end of the document, in the same way, you can cite your reference within the text in whatever way you want to cite. Okay, and on the top of it, one more thing which you'll be able to do is that you can cite while writing. You can cite while writing. It means like I am writing and now I want to cite. So you don't have to go to pick up that document, find that folder. You just open, once you'll integrate your Mendeley into your Word document, you will be able to access your entire Mendeley library from there itself, from your Word document only. And you just select and cite there. So you'll be able to cite there while writing only. So these are all some of the amazing features of this tool. And one more amazing thing is that there are many other reference management tools which are there in market, like EndNote, RefWorks. EndNote is also being incorporated in Scopus. EndNotes, RefWorks. But why it is most widely used Mendeley? Because it is free. Anybody can access it. It has got no subscription fees. And since we are using Scopus and it is incorporated over there also. So whenever I am searching Scopus and I'm finding some relevant articles and I want to save them in my Mendeley library for further citing them in my document. So the Mendeley thing would come over there in your Scopus also. I would show that. So when the Mendeley thing would come, you just save them in your Mendeley library. They would automatically come. So for that, you need to download Mendeley browser version. And for citing while writing, you need to incorporate the Word. I will tell you, these are very simple things, very straightforward things. It is a hardly 10 minutes job. But I want you to clarify the concept of what amazing functions this Mendeley can do. Then reference management, I have told that you'll be able to insert citations and you'll be able to produce bibliographies in a particular format. And then you would be able to read your document and highlight it. There is a feature with the help of which you will be able to read the document online. And if you want to highlight it, you'll be able to highlight. And you can also give notes against that highlighted part. Giving notes means you can give annotations. You can give annotations, can add notes to that highlighted part and can share it with other peers, other researchers working in the same field. This is a way to enhance your work, to enhance your visibility, not your work, sorry, to enhance your visibility. And it has got a feature in which you can create groups also, private groups like I belong to some subject and I would like to collaborate with other faculty members in my subject, but I don't want to make that group public. So I will create a private group. So five of us would keep on interacting with us. So see, I have accessed these and now I'm reading these highlights. I have given annotations. Please go through them and give notes to, give comments, observations. I'll be able to do that. And there are number of public groups which you can go and can refer to them. Collaboration, I have already told, you will be able to collaborate with 9 million researchers. Okay. And having said that, the one of the vital function which it is doing, for which it is very famous, is that reference management. You don't have to worry about management of your references. And why I just want to clarify why reference management is so important, because this I have already covered. Research in two senses, that which is adding something new, original to the existing pool. Okay, this is, which is not just interpreting that this has all happened. No interpretations. You also add your new dimensions. Add a single drop, but add something new to the research pool. So why reference management is important? One, it would protect you from plagiarism thing. Once you'll quote that, you have built up your thoughts on the basis of these references, you acknowledge those thoughts, so you are quite safe. You will not come into the category of academic misconduct. So references are quite important. And whosoever is studying your article, he'll be able to capture the preceding research pattern and findings. And then he'll be able to establish linkages with the past knowledge. Okay, currently this thing is happening. Like in coronavirus case, people are also studying about the last virus which came. I forgot, SARS. SARS virus. They are also searching content SARS, because they are saying they are similar. So past knowledge, and then references add value and validate research. Like I was telling, if a reference has appeared in patent, and if it would be qualitatively considered high quality, so it would add value and validate research. If you have included references of good books, good international body reports, so it would add value. Okay, she has gone through all these documents. She has gone through all these good qualitative documents. That is why she has given this list. So it adds value. It validates your research. And they authenticate the cited work. Whatever you are citing, you are authenticated in the end. See, I have given references. That is why references are so important. So this I have already covered. That it is it would let you build up your own virtual library, and that virtual library is completely portable. Then you'll be able to interact on a social networking platform of researchers amounting 9 million researchers. And one of the very good feature is that you will get to know, once you'll give a keyword, that see, I am working on this, like, for instance, I'm working on coronavirus or on artificial intelligence or on digital technology, whatever. If I'll type the keyword over there, it would let me know which are the funding bodies who are promoting research on this particular body, on this particular topic. Funding bodies across the world. And then that portal would let you know how many days are left to apply for this funding. If you really want to apply, you go. And funding across the world. And careers. If you want to switch over from one institution to another, and that to across, other than your country, you'll be able to know the various kinds of job opportunities which are there across the world. So I'll show you everything. When you'll be experiencing them live, you'll understand the importance and vitality. Okay, this I have already covered. Now we are going to experience, have patience. So I have covered the theoretical part. So how we will be going about it. If you permit me, can I have a sip of water? Yes. Now, how you will be able to access Mendeley. First and foremost, you go to this site, www.mendeley.com. Create your account over there. Creation of an account is such an easy thing. You just need to give your ID and password, the way you are creating your accounts on different kind of forums. You just go and create your account. This is the first step. After creating your account, only after creation of your account, it would let you download the software. What is that software? Mendeley desktop software. If you want to access Mendeley website, then also you need to register. There are two things which I would be showing. One is Mendeley website. With the help of that Mendeley website, you will be able to know the funding opportunities. You will be able to know the career opportunities. You will be able to know about the researchers across the world, 9 million researchers. But what this software would be doing? This software would be exclusively working for reference management. So first create an account and then download. This software is very essential. Download it. Download is very simple. Just go and download. It would ask you for next run, and the thing will get saved on your desktop. Then once you'll download it, you'll be able to open it, and you'll be able to create your own virtual library. I will be telling you how you'll be able to do that. Okay. And then once you will create your account, secondly, once you'll download the Mendeley desktop, what is the third step? The third step is, in the software, there is a tools tab. You install both MS Word plugin and Web Importer. Why you are installing both of them? MS Word plugin you are installing because whenever you will be writing your article in Word, you will be able to cite your references by this Word plugin, with the help of this Word plugin. And in the same manner, if you are searching something from web browser, like from Scooper, Springer, IEEE databases, or any other databases, if you have inserted this web importer on your browser, and I have downloaded it on my Google Chrome browser. So you, every time that icon would be there, you'll be able to save those references in your library right away from there. So now, without wasting our time further, give me a moment so that I should switch to Mendeley first. You want me to, it is 112. Yes, let me show you Mendeley first, because Mendeley we have not covered last time also. Scoopers, so you can further do experimentation, and if we'll be having time, I'll be discussing that also. Give me a moment. Dhruv, my screen is visible, beta?
Yes, ma'am, your screen is visible.
This Mendeley.com is visible?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, thank you, Bachi. So, this is Mendeley.com. Okay. Dhruv, I want to minimize it. How should I do this? Okay. Dhruv, can I minimize this thing which is coming on the right-hand side, this panel? Minimize, because it is obstructing my view.
I have no idea about this.
Okay, never mind. I'll manage. You just let me know whether in full screen this Mendeley screen is visible or not. It is, na?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, thank you, Bachche. So this is Mendeley screen. Okay, now I was telling you about funding thing. So I have already registered myself. So you'll be finding my name over here, Pooja. Okay. And then I have also installed web plugin over here. So in my Google, you'll be able to see the icon of this Mendeley in red color on my this address bar, near my address bar. This is there because I have installed that. Now, we'll just quickly run through what we were talking about, funding and all that. Okay. Let us go to funding. So, see, if I'll write, let me write coronavirus only. Okay. See, okay. Coronavirus, it is saying like this, ki there is no, what should I write? Digital marketing, right? This is very beautiful feature. Once you, it will get reflected on your screen, you'll see. See, I have written digital marketing. So it is saying in digital, on this topic, one funding opportunity is there and 95 days are left to apply for this funding opportunity. And this funding opportunity is by this university, and then you can further explore it. What is this? September 15th, the last date. This is, I have given a vague subject. Depending upon once I was searching, I was able to get good number of results for funding opportunities. Then over here, you can type the name, like, and then you can further specify it. You can further refine it within your narrow subject domain. Under what subject? Because all of the subjects these days are multidisciplinary in nature. Actually, whatever topic you are choosing, under which subject it falls, under which subject area you would like to pursue that research. So you filter that with the help of that. And then you see over here, it is showing if you want to get research for the purpose of your, you want to get funding for the purpose of research and publications. So it is the funding which is being displayed over here. It is for that purpose. For other purposes also, funding opportunities are there. Then with about, if you are saying, see, I am living in India. Okay. And in India, there is no opportunity on this specific topic. So this is the area. This left hand pane is the area where you can further refine your results. Digital marketing is not appealing me because it is not giving good number of results. Let me write artificial intelligence. I should keep them in quotes so that this we have discussed last time, and it applies universally. Whenever you are writing a two words phrase, you should enclose them within quotes so that computers should understand that it is a these two words should appear together. Oh my God. Thank God. I have chosen a good word. 65, because I was mentioning this thing, that active research area, you will be able to know that these many bodies are giving funding opportunities to researchers because this is the active research area. After ICT, artificial intelligence is gaining buzz. Now, 65 funding opportunities are there. So great. And actually, I've changed my this thing. Thank God. So this way you can browse which are these opportunities. Like over here, it is showing, and it is mentioning that is mid-career and experienced. This kind of funding is for what kind of researchers, at what stage they are in their career. They are mid-career, freshers, like that, and how many days are left to apply for this funding opportunities. Then you can further, because they are good number, 65. So you just want to further refine, and you may refine them on the basis of these parameters like we did in Scopus. You can refine that, them on the basis of subject areas. Like if I am interested in arts and humanities, just three funding opportunities are there in arts and humanities. In agriculture and biological sciences, the four. Like this it is showing. So artificial intelligence primarily belongs to computer science. So out of 65, 50 are falling under the subject area, computer science only. Okay. There are multidisciplinary other subjects also. It entirely depends upon you that in medicine also 7. why in medicine artificial intelligence is still a little higher number? Because robotic surgery, you must have heard about robotic surgery. It is a part of artificial intelligence only. So social sciences, two funding opportunities. So if you filter that these funding opportunities, because they are not exclusively for you, they are as per the subject. So you know your subject, under which subject you are studying that particular topic. You just select that subject and then just go to those opportunities, and you then this is funding type. This you'll be able to refine it. You want me to refine them? Okay, let me do this. Arts and humanities, all in this category. Okay, so three funding opportunities are there in the field of arts and humanities. They are there. Okay, now I will be showing you quickly all other things. Funding types, like if I'll write country of my, okay, my country, let me see if this, no, sorry, countries, funding type, I have funding type. Yes, you are looking for this funding either to pursue a program or project, or for pursuing a research, or to write a publication. So you can further refine. For a program and projects, two comes under this category, 2 out of 65. And out of these 65, one kind of publication, 65, sorry, three, because we have filtered. Initially, 65 funding opportunities came. We have filtered as per arts and humanities or social sciences. And out of these three, two are for towards programs and projects, and one is towards research and publications. And then country of citizenship in India, it is not there, let it be. Then you amount also you can refer. What amount of funding you are aspiring for, you can type. So if you don't want $500, you are looking for a good amount, reasonable amount, then you just find it would just filter that for the amount you are asking. These kinds of, like, see, amount is also there. Amount up to 1,50,000, I think it is. So if this much amount is there, I'm poor in maths, whatever zeros are there. Then application deadline, it is giving you, it is those summary of the funding opportunities is highlighting everything. It is highlighting which institution is funding, how many days are left, what is the amount which is being funded. Everything is there. Okay, and huge amounts are there, you can say. And you can further explore it. I'm just giving an example, a feel of it. And then it is, you want to filter your results on the basis of deadline. No, I won't be able to submit it within 14 days. I need more days. So let me see what funding opportunities are there which have got a deadline more than 90 days. So in this way, you can explore it. Application type. What kind of applicant you are? You are mid-career or whatever, funder. Okay. So if you are looking for a specific high profile funder, you know about that in your field, that this body is funding. So you may search whether this body is funding something on this topic. If you know the name, you will be able to. Like if I'll type, see, all the drop-up menu has come. If I'll type key, if any, this body, this is a reputed body internationally. If I just want to see anything this is funding on this, so I'll get to know. Okay, after that, this funding, I think that is clear. This is all about funding. Okay. Then careers. Yes. Like it is showing in which field you are looking for job, where, in what kind of institution you are looking for a job. Like if you go down, it is showing you subject wise. Like in agriculture and biology, that 3,920 job openings are there, and these job openings are across the world. In arts and humanities, let us go to, see, subject wise you can go, social sciences, and the number, how many job openings are there, the number is also displayed over there, and all of them are hyperlinks. So let me go to arts and humanities. So lecturer in English, which university is asking lecturer in English, this subject. Then everything, grade, which grade is there, which university is asking, everything. And you further, with this refined tools, you can further refine your results. and archaeology in arts and humanities again is a broad thing. You can further filter it down to the particular area in which you are having expertise. So accordingly you can do. And then the job type it is showing, which type job type you are asking, COC. Then location, where you want to get to London. There are openings in London. There are openings in Southeast England, Scotland, Asia Pacific, where you want to go to gain further enhance your experience. Salary band, you are working at a particular salary band. You obviously would want to go at a better one, on a better grade. Contract time, you want to have a full-time kind of job, part-time contract. Recruiter type means you would like to, yes, this is very important for us. Universities and colleges, all of us are in higher educational institutions. So obviously, since we have been working for the last 20 years in educational institutions, we'll find a job, a apt job for us in universities and colleges only. So we'll search for this. Like out of these would be pertinent or apt, suitable for me. So 117 jobs are there. So you will be able to browse through them. Now, see, many things are there. You can, like I was telling you in Scoopers, you can set an alert also. Once you log in yourself to this Mendeley, and you will say, see, I'm interested in this kind of job. And you just give me an alert over email whenever a new job opening is coming up. So you will get an alert over email. The way last time I was sharing you on Scoopers that we were searching for coronavirus and economies, the impact of coronavirus on economies. And I was showing you that, see, we can put an alert also. Now, for the last so many days, since May 27 till today, I've got two mail alerts. Kisi Pooja Gulati, it's new documents have been added to Scoopers Index pertaining to coronavirus. And if you are interested, please go through that. So you can set an alert over here. You'll be receiving those alerts over email. You don't have to go to Mendeley again and again if you want to do that. Find a position, a position-wise, academic position, all employers. Let us see what kind of employers are listed over here. It is everything is crowdsourced over here. This is crowdsourced over here to give you information on a single portal. See, these are the bodies which are providing employment opportunities across the globe. So this is all, how many employers are there? Is it giving number? No, it is not giving number ki how many employers are there. Never mind. And this funding, I have explained. Further, whenever you'll be going to site, you can further experiment with it. Careers, I have given. Then library. Then groups. Let me just first tell you groups. Groups, as I was mentioning, that this group I have created, Research Network. Okay? I am the owner of this group. But I have created this group. I have put this group in the category of private. I don't want everybody, because it is this Mendeley is on cloud. It is the server is there on the cloud. If I make it public, whosoever is subscribing to Mendeley or is attached to Mendeley, like I am mentioning 9 million researchers are attached to Mendeley, they'll be able to see my group and access my references and my peers' references also. So I don't want that. So I have created this. Creation of group is very, very easy. You just go, I will be telling you, you just go create a group. That's all. And then library. See, though we'll be using this library, software independently, but I'm showing you from your web browser also, you will be able to see your library. So this way, library looks like this. Whenever you will be downloading your Mendeley, once it would get downloaded, what would appear on your screen? See, the screen would appear like this. In this left-hand panel, you'll see the folders. In this left-hand panel, you'll see the folders with the help of which you may organize all your references. And where is your library, which I was mentioning, that you will be able to create a virtual library. This central pane, which is visible to you, this is my library. this is my library and this central pane is showing I have saved these many documents. This is the title of the document, the topmost title which is there in my library is Exploring COVID-19 Pandemic, Its Impact to Global Aviation Industry and the Key Strategy. It is being written by these authors and it is published in International Journal of Advanced Science and Technology in 2020. And the date on which I have added this reference to my library is 10th of June. Okay, like this, it has, so how many are there? 1,296 references. On the bottom of the bottom thing, you'll be able to see 50 references at a time it is showing. And how many in total are there? In total, there are 1,296. 1,296 references till now I have added to my library. And how I have added, I just want to give you a feel, how does your Mendeley library look like? Okay, and when you'll be selecting any document, see, actually your screen, whenever you'll open your Mendeley thing, your screen will basically gets divided into three parts. Okay, the first part, the left hand part, is a folder part. Okay, the middle part is the most important part, and that is the widest part, which would show you all the references, which would display all the references which you have collected so far. And if you further want to know what kind of resource is this, or you want to make some changes in your resources, you just go to it, highlight it, and if you click it like this, this right hand panel will show you, okay, this article is, the title of this article is this, these are the authors, this is being published in the very sought after prominent medical science journal Lancet, which is last time we were seeing that this is the only journal followed by EPW which is contributing the most of the literature on coronavirus. So and the volume number of the journal, these all are the address. For references, what we'll be needing for references, whenever we'll be quoting this, we'll be needing which volume number, on which year, which issue number, on what on which page numbers this article has appeared. It has given everything. Then background of this is also given. You can go more to that. Okay, and likewise DOI is also there. If you want to provide a digital object identifier along with your citation, you can also do that. It is also given over there. ISSN number of that journal is also there, and on which date you have access. Then fortunately, full text of this document is also there. Okay, so full text I'll be showing you in that, how you'll be able to highlight and annotate. Annotations I was telling you, that I'll be telling you a little later. So this is, the three windows are there. In right hand panel, you'll be able to gather the details of that document. And the beauty of this is that you'll be able to make changes in that. And one tip which I would like to give is that, see, it is not a full text thing. You like, you see over here, it's this is PDF is there, PDF is there, PDF is there. But others, this PDF thing is not coming. Why? Because this is not a database. This is a library where you are saving your bibliographic details of documents so as to enable you to cite them whenever you will be writing your article. But it is an added advantage. But whenever you are downloading something, if the PDF is also coming along. But all the time that PDF is not coming along. But never mind, because for references, you're not needing PDF. PDF, you have already accessed and read it from your source thing. You just want to make a library of those references so as to cite them. I think I am able to communicate what I really want to communicate. This is a library for keeping, for organizing, for recording your references and to make searches within your within your references. Like I have saved 1,296 references. Would it be humanly possible for me to remember all the 1,296 references? No. So I'll be able to search within my references on with this topic, with what reference I had saved. Let me see. And if you want to save them separately in separate kind of folders, so you may do that. Whatever you will add to your library, that would get saved in your folder, which is there in left-hand panel, recently added. Recently added, whatever you'll add, it would be saved in your recently added folder. But if you want to bifurcate them as per the topic, say if I am working on 4 papers, so obviously I want to keep their references separately. So I will be doing that by creating separate folders. Okay, so this is how your screen looks like when you open the Mendeley software. This is not Mendeley software. I'm just giving you a feel. This is the web browser of Mendeley, Mendeley.com. Why we have come over here? Because first I would like to give you a glimpse of that from Mendeley.com, apart from this reference management, what other things you may do? Groups you may create for collaboration, like I have created for giving you an example. Then careers, you may search for a job. And then funding. This is the most beautiful and attractive part for any aspiring researcher. Like, see, subject wise also it is showing. So despite of writing, like I wrote that, and then my second key term was able to retrieve good number of results, 65 or 64. You can directly go as per the subject that my research area falls broadly into this subject. So you search your funding opportunities in as per your subject. And then it is again asking, see, for social sciences, it is showing 5,165 funding opportunities. Now you can further refine them as per the narrower area, which is there in social sciences. Now I think I have explained enough of it. And now I should go to the software part. This is all which is there, very simple, pretty straightforward. So we have covered this thing. Okay, you want me to show this also. Let me see. I was mentioning, Dhruv, now Delhi University screen is visible, bachche?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So, like I was mentioning how you will be able to get remote access to e-resources. So, once you will get that email, you will go to this web link, DUE library. It's okay. The window will get open, username, password, login. I was asked to show this. That's why I'm showing it. And then you will come to this subscribed resources list. You just click it and it's an alphabetical list, as I was telling you. You will go to Scopus. Why I am going to Scopus? I just want to show you how Mendeley is incorporated into Scopus and how you will be able to import your documents into Scopus also. Directly from Scopus into Mendeley. Like I am taking very generic example all the time because this is the key thing which is getting highlighted all the time on media also. So COVID-19, then you I hope all of you have got some hands on this and must be familiar with all the things which we discussed last night. 3 billion, I'm not going to repeat all of them because I'm assuming the participants are similar. Okay, COVID-19 or corona virus, or I am writing because they both of them are used interchangeably, one and the same thing. I just want to show you how I will be able to import my findings into my Mendeley thing. This time, let me see aviation. Okay. Last time we, because it is in fact impacting everything. This pandemic is affecting everything. Aviation. This is one of the very sensitively hit sector. You want me to use other things also? Okay. There are advisories. Because of this trend of advisories, every institution, every body is issuing advisory. You should do this like this. So let us write advisory. And now this asterisk symbol I'm using. Sorry. Okay, asterisk symbol, it will take all the forms of the root word. I'm not going to explain it because we already did that. So now 28 documents have come. Let me see. 28 documents have come. Now, if I want to save all these 28 documents, they are not that big in number, and all these to my Mendeley. When I'll open my Mendeley, you'll be able to see I have picked up because I have incorporated it in my web browser. See, if I'll not incorporate it in my web browser, then it would not get reflected in Scoopers also. Because though it is inbuilt in Scoopers, but for that you need to plug in this web browser. I'll tell you how. So once you'll select it, since you have already plugged in that web browser, it is say save to Mendeley. Save to Mendeley means all these documents, 28 documents, would be saved in my Mendeley library. I'll show you. That is why I have come to Scoopers. And when now I am there at Scoopers, because that software part is very simple. If I'll be covering that in last, you will be able to remember that. When I am there in Scoopers, Abbas, this is the only thing you'll be doing. You just select save to Mendeley. Okay. And you can create bibliography from here also. You can create bibliography from here also. Plus, I'll be showing you how you'll be incorporating it in your Word document. Let us see from here also. Up now it's asking you want to save it. I want to save it as a PDF. And it would say if you'll be saving it in PDF, all these information will be covered. Okay, save as PDF. It is coming. It's taking, I think it has come. Sorry, I did not notice. See, for all the documents, my bibliography is ready. See how instant and how easy it is. See, my bibliography is ready, and the kind I had already selected. That is why it knows ki I have selected the style. AP I have selected. I'll tell you everything. You don't have to worry about that. And now let me keep this Scoopers open only, because I really want to touch upon 2-3 important points about Scoopers. Let me tell them, because otherwise I'll feel that I miss them this time also. Yes, I was mentioning one thing, that if a journal is bragging that it is Scoopers indexed and you really want to cross-check that, you go to sources. Okay, see, 41,154 results. It means 41,154 journals are indexed in this database. And you can download this Scoopers source list from here. It would get downloaded in Excel format. In Excel format, and it would let you know whether that particular journal is actively associated with this, or it is not active, disqualified. See, from here, and it would show the period also. I am not going to download it. It's a very time consuming thing. We are short of time. So this is the only way. If you want to see what all journals are being indexed by the Scoopers, you just download this Scoopers source list, and this would get downloaded in Excel format, and you will be able to know this is the name of the journal since when it is getting indexed in this Scoopers database, and till when. If it is being written till 2017, it means Scoopers has disqualified after 2017. After now, it is no more Scoopers indexed journal. So this is one of the things which I forgot to quote last time. And one thing more which I would like to highlight, I'll finish it in 1-2 minutes, because this too we have already covered everything. We have, you must have be remembering that affiliation we covered, then we were prompted with a beautiful charts. See, this institution is producing content in this subject highest, followed by this, those beautiful charts are importable. You can import them and can produce them in your document. Then author wise, we have always seen, and the most widely used window is document only, because whenever you are doing document thing, what you are getting the entire information on that window. Again, I would show you how. See, once your author is already coming, so no need to go to author. You can see the profile from here. Source is also, if you want to know about the safety science thing, you can directly go from there. Okay, so document is the most widely used window. for author you are using, if you are specifically using, like I was mentioning in my example, let me just say Rao CNR, a chemistry expert person, scholar. See, his H index is 134. Okay, and he's still with Jawaharlal Nehru Center for Advanced Scientific Research. So his H index is 134, and how many documents against his name? 1,663. And whereas that I-10 index of Google Scholar was telling that his H index is 155. This also just wanted to show you. And one thing more, compare sources so that you'll get to know. Sorry. Yes. Last time I covered it very superficially. Like I would like to compare two sources, Lancet. Again and again, I'm saying it is one of the sought after journals, widely read journal in the field of medical sciences. Okay. Sorry. Actually, my laptop is new, so I'm not that friendly with this laptop. Okay. Now 15 journals are there which have got this word Lancet, but I am looking for this Lancet. Okay. See, now I really want to cover this point. See, now this is showing site score, which is a refined version of generic impact factor. Then what this is showing? Three metrics I was explaining, the SCIMAGO, which is representing the prestige and reputation of that journal. Okay. And this is the source normalized impact factor. Three indexes I wanted to show. Then citations by year also. So last time we did citation analysis of a document. This time we are going through citation analysis of a particular journal. And we'll be comparing two journals. See, so for all the three metrics, you'll be able to know what is the site score of this journal, site score number of this journal, SGR number of this journal, SNIP number. And one thing which I would like to highlight over here is, and I really want all of you to pay attention to this, is that when, so see, if you have reached a stage that you want to publish in best of the best journals in your area, and see, you have shortlisted, either I will be publishing in Lancet or I will be publishing in Nature. So how you would be deciding in which I should publish? You, that the site score and all these three indexes, apart from that, you need to look at this thing also. Documents by year. Why you need to look at this thing also? I am telling you why. Because in 1996, how many documents are produced by Lancet? 2,754. Okay. And in since 1996, now in 2020, 486 documents. The number of documents being published by Lancet in a year. In a year. This is the year-wise information. Okay. Like in this year, 2012, 1,859. In 2012, total number of 1,859 articles got published in Lancet. If I'll compare it with, okay, so number is on an average is more than, see, initially it was more than nearing 3000, nearing 2500. Okay, now they have reduced their number. So, but it is still more than 1500. Okay, now, it's not going down. Never mind. If what I'm trying to highlight over here is like this, then you, whatever next journal you'll be typing, again you'll be going on this window, source document by year. Then you'll seeing if, for instance, that particular journal among which both the two you are comparing, that is publishing just 500 articles in a year. And how much this is publishing? 2754. that which other one, the prominent one you are thinking of getting your article published in, that is publishing on an average 500 articles in a year. But this is publishing on an average 1500 articles. Even in fact, in some years, more than that. So three times, the probability of getting your article published in a journal gets three times more in this journal, because the number of documents published by this particular journal in a year is three times more than that journal. Though that journal is also very prominent in that particular field. But this is a kind of parameter on the basis of which you can decide and can assess the probability where your article stands a good chance of getting published. This is the thing which I missed last time, and this is very important. And the second thing, these charts, you'll be able to see the comparison with the help of charts as well as with the help of tables. See, if you are not comfortable in going through this, you see this information in tabular form. Okay, 1996, these many documents were produced. In these year, these many documents were produced. Okay, this was the thing which I was trying to share. I think sources, compare sources. So you'll go, you'll write the name of the title. And last time someone was asking me, is there any journal or international finance? Yes, if you want to know that, you just go to search this sources information. Type over there international finance, all the journals will come, and at a time you can make comparison within 10 journals, and those journals would be pop up over there. These many journals are there on this keyword which you have typed. So this is the way to find out on a particular topic whether a journal exists in this database or not, and you can also compare them. And this comparison, if you'll do that by document by year, you'll get to know the probability of getting your article published, and you will be able to assess and evaluate your decision on the basis of that, apart from site score and other parameters. And when you are comparing two sources, we are assuming that you are comparing equal kind of sources, because you have reached a stage when you want your article to get published in prominent high impact factor journals. So obviously you will be comparing two high impact journals only. You won't be comparing one less impact journal with a high impact journal. Okay, this is all about Scopus, which I could not cover last time. The three indexes I have shown. Yes, field weighted citation index, you want me to show? Because I'm, okay. Field weighted citation index, like I have already told you, it would global world average. If it is more than one, it is considered more than average. If it is that is simply a number, like we access the H index of CNN or Rao, the 134 number was coming. That number would determine whether the article is qualitatively average, good, or towards a bad or poor state. Okay, this is all about Scopus. Let us not spend more time on that. Now with this, let me again stop share. Stop it. And now I'll be sharing my new screen, that is of Mendeley desktop. Give me a moment to share that. Dhruv, my Mendeley desktop is visible over there, Bichhe?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, thank you, Bichhe. So, since I have downloaded it, I got myself registered in this. So, that is why whenever I'll be opening my Mendeley desktop, as an icon of Mendeley desktop would rest over there in your downloads, or if you'll bring them on your desktop, the icon of Mendeley desktop would appear on your desktop. You just have to double click it. The moment you double click it, this window would get open, which I was showing you through our web browser also. Three panes are there. Okay. And now this thing would be empty for you. When as a fresher, this thing would be empty. Your library would be empty. My library is not empty because I have already added some articles in my virtual library over here. And now we would learn that these are the summary. I have been explaining it, like authors given, titles given, year, where it is published, when it is added. Now I can sort them. sorting in the sense it would, like we learnt in Scopus, it would organize all my documents alphabetically. These documents have got no authors, so they have come on the top. Then alphabetically A to Z, the author wise it has been sorted. Likewise, you can sort it as per the title, as per the year. By default, it was coming, the latest ones were coming at the top. Now, in reverse order, it is coming. Like alphabetically, where it is published, I'm able to sort as per the publication date and over here. Now, okay. Now, what does this green thing? I am explaining everything one by one. I have already explained all these panes, how to sort them. And then what does this green mean? This green means I have added them in my library, but I have not gone through them. And if they are not green, it means I have gone through them. I have read them. They are unread. Okay. And I can sort them as per the reading thing also. If I want to see how many references I have added and how many of them I have not gone through, you sort them. Sort them over here. You'll be able to find. Okay. And what is this star? This star means you can mark some of the references as your favorite ones. These are my favorite ones. So this is how you can fiddle within your library. And now you must be thinking, what should I do? You just tell me how to add documents in the library. How this, when, because whenever you'll be opening, what you'll be doing? You'll be going to Mendeley.com. First step. Second step, you will be logging in. You will be logging in with the help of your email ID and password. Once you assign yourself, register yourself with the Mendeley website, then you will Mendeley desktop. Mendeley desktop, you will download. That icon would appear on your downloads. Then you drag it on your desktop. Once you will double click it, this window would get open. But this window, this left pane would be there. This pane would be there. And this right pane would be empty and this middle pane would be empty. Now the major task is, and the only task, simple task, which you will be doing with this, that add a document. Let me show you that, how you will be adding a document in a Mendeley library. Oh, I'm sorry. Dhruv, my screen is still visible or gone?
No, ma'am, it's gone.
Oh, sorry. Give me a moment. I'm doing that. Now it's visible, bache?
No, ma'am. It's visible?
Okay. Never mind. I'm doing that again. Oh, sorry. Now visible, Peter?
Yes, ma'am, it's visible now.
Okay. Because I want to drag something over here, that is why I need to contract my, it was in full screen, so I was not able to drag. So what I was telling you, like this thing is empty whenever you are starting afresh. So how you would be doing something, like I have got a document over here, I'll just drag it and drop it over here. So again and again, I'm apologizing for this fact, because this laptop, I'm not that sorry, because this is laptop, I'm very new to it. It's an Apple laptop. Just now I have started using it in a day or two only. So what you'll be doing it, like these PDF documents are there, like a simple thing, whenever you are dragging over here there, you just drag it and place it over here in your, like, let me just try. Okay, sorry, I'm not able to, because I'm not that friendly with this new keypad. So you just need to, if they are there on your desktop or if they are on your any of the folders, you just drag them and keep it over here in this central plane. They'll come automatically. Or alternatively, you can add them from here. Add a file or add a folder. Okay. And then you can further Let me do it. So I'm never mind. So I hope you, this is very simple thing. You will be able to do that. Drag and drop, then your library would be there. And whatever you will be added, it would be there in your recently added thing. And then you can further select all of them and can create new folders and can organize your thing as per the as per your need. Okay, then this is a for sorting. We did sorting. Then we how we'll be filtering our results. We can filter them as per the these authors, tags, keywords, publications. Like I just want to read my thing, which is being published in Journal of Travel Medicine. Okay, so it would filter my results out of my 1200 something, whatever references I have added to my library, it would filter. So when you will play with them, you'll get to know. And one thing which I would saying, which I was mentioning, that it is a portable thing. You can access it from anywhere. To make it portable, you need to click this sync button. Sync button. To make it portable, remember, you need to click this sync button, then only your library will become portable. And how you will be adding now that now this thing is very simple. How you will be adding references to your thing, you will be going to wherever your documents are there, you just drag them in. Or so the way we are adding any document in anything, add, file, folder, the way you will be able to do that. And if you are downloading something from a publisher's website like Scopus, I have already shown that web importer icon would appear on your taskbar. You just select the things and those things will get saved on your Mendeley library directly. They'll come over here. Like, okay. Like we were adding something. We have recently added something from Scopus. Everything has come over here. Those 28 documents on tourism and something we were adding. Na? So they have come. Now, yes, one thing more. This thing I forgot to mention. This I have already mentioned. This is what? See, when I press this arrow, my documents are sorted and on the topmost thing, what documents have come? All the PDF documents have come. Like I was mentioning that this is a library. It is not a database that all the references would come along with complete PDFs. But if you want to see how many references are there with their complete PDF, you just have to press this arrow button. All the PDFs will come like this. Now this PDF, now I want to read this PDF. See, I'll be able to read this PDF completely. And if I want to highlight, I was telling you now, you can post your just highlight. And if you want to give a note to it, you just add a note to it. You have highlighted it with the help of this. And then what note you abstract, whatever note. I'm just giving you an example, abstract. Okay. And just now, and where these notes would come, notes would come further. You can from here you can access them. Okay. And you can change the colors and all that. This you can do. So if I'll be sharing this PDF with my peers who are also working on the same, they will be able to see this document with all these annotations. Okay, whenever they'll be giving in this right hand panel, this highlighted portion would appear to them and they will be able to see what notes, annotations I have assigned to that highlighted portion. Okay, now this is the main menu bar. Now this is the place, please. This is the only thing which you need to learn. There just two things are there. It is pretty simple. Just two things you need to learn about Mendeley. One, how to add documents. And documents will be added either manually from your desktop or you'll be downloading them from the websites. Both of the things I have shown. Now, how you'll be installing, because I did that for my Mendeley. You will be going to this tools menu, and then you will be, because my thing is installed, already installed, it is saying uninstall. You just need to say install MS Word plugin. You just need to click install MS Word plugin. Whenever you will open your Word document, under references, the icon of Mendeley would appear and it would let you insert your citation while writing your document. So this is the only thing you need to do. Go to do tools and say install MS Word plugin. And in the same way for browser, you go to tools and say install web browser or web importer. So it would say ask you for which browser you are asking. Firefox, Google, whichever, Chrome. So whichever browser you are using, you select that browser and that would appear. So this is the only thing which you will be doing. Now. This is all about Mendeley. Now, most of the things I have covered, I think, sorting, filtering, and annotations, and in one thing which I would like to show is that you can also perform literature search. Let me go to my library. Yes, a literature search also you can do from here. There are the references which you have saved in your library. But because I was mentioning that this entire information is on cloud, so you will be able to access the related content also with the help of this literature search menu. Okay. Literature search, I am not going to show it because you know how to search. You just give a keyword and you'll be able to, and from there you can see the documents of your interest. See, I have created some documents, PDF, coronavirus, search results. I have created some folders to organize my references. So this is all about Mendeley. Now we will be going to Word. Okay. Again, I need to share my screen, na Dhruv?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. Okay. I am doing that.
It's visible, ma'am.
Word document is visible?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, great. So see over here, I did it last night for just giving a feel to you. I'll be explaining it. Okay. Now, in this references, because I have incorporated that na, Mendeley into. So it is showing, see, it is showing over here, insert citation. Merge citations. If you are quoting, if you would like to cite two citations together, you'll be able to do that. Okay. And styles. It would, as I was telling you, that it would let you play with your citations in more than 7,500 styles. And it depends upon what kind of citation your particular journal is asking. And how you will get to know that this particular journal is following which citation style, you'll go to the author's guide. Abstract and indexing subset, and over there you will find that this citation style is being followed by this journal. 99% of times you will find this over there. If it is not there, you can write to the editor of the journal that which citation style you are following, and I am using Mendeley for preparing my bibliography and references. Just let me know what name it is there. They'll let you know and you can search that. Now let me do that. I will cite. This is cite while write. Okay. And now I'm just giving you an example. And now I want to cite. Okay. Let me open a fresh document. Because in the night also when I was practicing, it was giving some kind of problem. Let me open a fresh Word document. Never mind. Okay. Okay. Let me just. This is site. Okay. And references. Insert citation. Oh, sorry. Cancel. Sorry. This is. Let me just once again open it. I was trying to install this Mendeley desktop on my old laptop only, but it was not getting installed. The reason it was saying that your window bit size is, it should be itna. Maybe the memory, there was some issue with memory. That is why I switched to this laptop. Oh, thank God. So below references, this insert citation is coming. I'm praying that it should work. Because I was able to download this desktop version very with so much of difficulty. Okay, now insert citation. I think, let me just see whether this is open or not. I am extremely sorry about this technical glitch. Let me see. Syncing part I did. The syncing is very important and it should be open. When you are citing your document in Word document, the desktop should be open. Your Mendeley desktop should be open. And it should be in minimized mode. Okay. And now insert citation. I am so sorry about it. It's not working. But let me just try once more. Please give me a chance because it is very simple and it is very beautiful. I really want to share it with you. It's because of some technical glitch. It's not happening. When I was doing that, and that is why I have saved this document. Let me just. Explain you with the help of this document, because with the help of this example, you'll. What I did when I was writing that, I just. So see, if I want to cite something over here, what I will do, I'll go over here, I'll say insert citation, and what it would do, it would open up a small window over here, which would show me my open library. It would say me open library, or it would give you a window kind of thing. And it would ask you to type a keyword or author's name or publisher of your reference. Once you will type that, it would come over here as a citation. Like last night when I was doing it for you people, I did that and it picked it up. That is why it has come over here like this. But because of some technical glitch right now, I have tried many a times. It is, I don't know why it is doing that. It's very bad of technology. Never mind. I'm extremely sorry about that. But it is very, very simple. I'm telling you the steps. You just need to plug in the Word plugin. This has already been done. That is why this Mendeley is there. And now whenever you, whatever you'll write, you'll go to that. And when you'll click this insert citation, a small kind of pop-up window would come. And it would ask you which reference you would like to see. You will, and the complete list will come alphabetical if you want to see. You can directly go to Mendeley also. If you'll open Mendeley, then Mendeley desktop would come. Mendeley desktop would come. From there you can pick up and select. Just select. Go to that, select, click. This reference would come in whatever format. Like I have selected APA format. This reference would come, and wherever I want to cite, the similar manner I'll be citing. And at the end, wherever I'll be keeping my cursor and will be saying insert bibliography. Okay, it is here. Insert bibliography. It would ask me in what format you would like to insert. So I think this document has got corrupted. Nothing is happening. So just insert bibliography. So you will, it would ask you in which format you, at the point of cursor, whatever citations you have used within your text, for all those citations, complete reference list would come. And at the end of this, I would like to highlight that there is a slight difference between references and bibliography. In my earlier session also, I mentioned again, I would like to brush up that. So references, whatever things you are mentioning within your document, citing them, it means you are quoting, you are giving acknowledgement to those documents that I have referred to them while writing this content. So, and the listing is there at the end of the document, that is called reference list. But if you are naming that list as bibliography, that is no more a reference list. That means you have included not only those documents which are cited by you within that document, but also the related literature which you want your readers to go and study. But you yourself have not studied them, but you are giving them a broader idea that, see, these are also other documents which you may refer. So this is the terminologically difference between reference list and bibliography. And but over here, this is saying bibliography, insert bibliography. It means whenever you'll be inserting bibliography, whatever citations, this is the only thing you need to do. This is the only thing you need to do. I hope I am able to make it understand to you people. Again, I am getting it revised that you only go to Mendeley site, because Mendeley is a super, so we have been discussing since last session. Again, I want to get it revised. You just go to Mendeley site, get yourself registered with it, download Mendeley desktop like this. Dhruv, it is visible, na?
No, ma'am, your desktop is visible only.
Yeah, desktop. Yeah, I'm saying desktop only. So see, on this taskbar, Mendeley desktop is there. It looks like this. It has got three panes. Whatever documents you will be adding, you will be picking. Oh, wow. Thank God. So yeah, see, this way, I'm learning Apple. So this way, I think you will be able to. So you just. If you'll permit, you see this way, okay? This way you'll just drag them and put them over here. They are added. They are no more on your desktop. This way you'll build your library. And from website, I have already told you, just select the, like, if you want to show me a Google thing, let me show you that. But it is always advisable to download articles from publisher's website. Don't download it from Google and other sites, because it is quite possible that on Google the reference details are incomplete. If, for instance, if you are downloading some reference details of a journal and Google is quoting that it is volume number so and so, but it is volume and issue number, it is wrongly quoted over there, then whenever somebody would be consulting your document, they'll get to know, oh my God, references are being given so carelessly. So if you are downloading the document which you want to, incorporate in your library, always advisable to download them from a reputed website and not from Google. Reputed website means publisher's website. Like Google Scholar still is a reputed website. Like you must be thinking that this is her favorite topic. It is not, but it is the. Okay. Now, so many documents have come. I want to add them from this browser. That thing I have shown you, just simply drag and now. I will go to Mendeley. This is actually this something is coming over here. I'm not able to click my Mendeley. Okay, thank God. See, I click my Mendeley web importer. Okay, now I'll sign in. This I'm doing for saving the reference details from a website. Okay. So it is not asking for my login details because I have already. So they see up now it is saying ki which documents from these displayed documents which are displayed over here on this website you want to save them in your Mendeley website. So 12 references they have deducted on this particular page. Okay. So and add PDFs if available. It is saying if PDFs are there, so add them. If I'll disable them, it would not add PDFs. But why would I disable them? I would like to have PDFs. So, and if I would like to select all of them, I would select all of them. And now this add is enabled. You just add. That's it. It's so simple. So what I did, I went to this Google Mendeley icon, which is there against the address bar, and I signed in. And after signing in, automatically it gave me these listing. Let's see the page which you are surfing. This has got so many references. You want to select all of them, and you want to add PDFs also in your library. I said okay to all, and then it is doing that. And if I want to view my library, I can view my library from here only. See, with these I have downloaded from my Google. So this is how I'll be building. See, he's saying na Google Scholar se liya apne. So this is how I will be building my library. Either I'll be saving it from my folders, or I'll be bringing the documents from the respective websites. And from bringing them respective websites, you don't have to download them. You save them, then bring them on the desktop, then drag them. Directly do that by having this web importer. And web importer, how you will be doing that? You will be doing that by going to tools and install web importer. And for incorporating these references while writing your article within the text, and for producing the bibliography and references, you just need to go to tools, install the Word plugin, which I was showing you, but unfortunately it did not work. I'm extremely, extremely sorry about that. But my previous laptop was not handling this Mendeley because of some memory issue. That is why I have switched to this. So, okay, this is our Mendeley library. This I'm closing. And this way you will be able to, this Mendeley thing will good go under references. This Mendeley would come, whatever you'll write. So, one last time I want to, let me just, because I'm seriously feeling guilty about it. Blank document. I'm seriously praying God ki I'll be able to show you. No, there is some problem. There is some problem. That is why it is my Mendeley desktop is also open, but it was working. Somehow it's not working right away, but it is so easy. It, when you'll say this kind of window would come, it would say open Mendeley and whatever, you just pick them up and whatever citation, then you come to cursor, insert bibliography. I think I am over with my content. And now I can open the forum for any clarifications, observations, comments, or any queries if you people have, or if you want to add something new to our next lecture series, you please feel free to ask. May I now ask Aarti or Dhruv to kindly take over the session?
Thank you, Pooja, for such a interesting session. So yes, we have a few queries, and I'm sure you will be able to answer every query. So the first question comes from Sadhana Jain. She asked, like, how to find out number of citation of a particular paper?
Oh, that is very simple. When you will be typing any keyword in document search in Scopus, okay, then you will get the details. Like, see, on the topic on which you are searching, these are the documents which are available in our Scopus database. And then their details would come. Their details would come. This is the title. This is the author. So on their details, over there, sorting option is there. By default, that sorting would be as per the latest date. What is the latest date document? So you just go to that sorting window and click the drop down menu from there and click the cite by highest. Cite by highest. So with all your documents would get sorted as per the number of citations. So the document having the maximum number of citations would come on the top. And against every document, the number of citations would be there. Like in first document, if the number of citations, highest number is 51, it would show that this document is having 51 citations. So now you'll be able to know, you'll be get to know this document has got this much citations.
Okay, next question
comes
from Dr. Archer. She asked, that what is more beneficial, thesis published in the form of book or research paper?
I see, it is my personal thing. I would say research paper. And again, there are many parameters which we have been discussing, that it depends on what kind of research paper it is, that where it is being published. Okay, so if it is being published in a reputed journal, and what kind of book you are referring to, whether that research thesis which is being transformed into a book format, it depends upon many factors. But as I was mentioning, that you will always give priorities to journals and conference proceedings followed by all these things. But obviously patents would come above that. Patents, because government organizations have patented that. It means a good result, a good outcome has come out of your research. So patents, the citations, if are there, and a patent document is there, if you want to refer, that is obviously more qualitative than an article.
Okay. Mr. Sachin from Central University, Haryana, would like to know why Web of Science and Scopus show different citation for the same article. Why do they differ in the citation?
Okay. This I have tried to cover. See, why they are showing different citations? Because the sources which they are indexing are different. I was mentioning that the content coverage in Scopus is bigger than Web of Science. When their content coverage is bigger, when they are, say, for instance, if Scopus is, I'm just giving an example, Scopus is indexing 100 sources and Web of Science is indexing 60 sources. So the number of citations Scopus would be retrieving on the basis of citations appeared in those 100 sources, and Web of Science would be retrieving the number of citations based on those 60 sources. So obviously, it is quite possible that in the remaining 40 sources, the citations would have appeared. That is why the number of citations are varying, bigger in Scopus and in Web of Science. So because of the variation in the number of sources being covered by both the databases. So H-index, it applies to H-index also. The H-index may also vary.
Okay, next question is from Nikita from Sri Bhagat Singh College. She asked, to avoid plagiarism, can we copy the citations from the Google Scholar by using the cite function? This function gives the citation in total 5 format. Is this legitimate?
Yes, it is also legitimate. It is because what they are doing, they are also letting you cite your citations as per the authorized styles, and there are many authorized styles, and some of the commonly used are American Psychological Association style, APA, MLA, Modern Language Association style, Chicago. So it is giving you a feature, an additional feature that you can let through. You can use that also, that is not a problem. But Mendeley, I am advising, because it is very comfortable that you, once you'll incorporate it, plug in your word, you will be able to. And one of the best things which Mendeley is doing is it is taking care of all your references on cloud. You don't have to worry about it. You don't have to save them anywhere else.
I'm sure we are able to sort Leela Joshi's queries, which actually asked about how do we install Web Importer and what is its relevance. So next question comes from Deepika Swami. She asked, in Scopus, can we download all issues of any particular journal?
See, Scopus is not a full text database. It is a database which is providing you abstracts and citations. And it would give you how many journals are indexed in this. If you really want to access the full text articles of that particular journal, then it would direct you. If you really want to access this full text, it would direct you this from this site, you will be able to access it.
Okay, Nitin Wilson would like to know, are the journal indexed by Scopus have the same citation number?
I'm not able to understand what is the question.
Okay, fine. Let's come to the next question. Nitin, they'll definitely answer your query.
No, you just repeat.
Have to actually find the question in the chat box again. So actually he asked about, are the journal indexed by Scopus have the same citation numbers? This was the question asked.
So see, as I have been mentioning for so long, widely used, there are two citation-based databases, Scopus and Web of Science. I don't think any other is there. So if everything depends upon the kind of literature they are indexing. Okay, if I am keeping track of 10 things, so I'll be able to extract information on the basis of those 10 things only. No? So it all depends on the kind of content, the coverage of the content in these databases. So it entirely depends upon their content. From Scopus and Web of Science, they may vary, and these are the only two sources. And the third one is Google Scholar. For whenever you are retrieving any measure, any index and metric through Google Scholar, it would be high, because I have explained it many a time why it would be high, because they would take into account social networking sites as well as Google Books database. And one thing more I would like to add over here, that is PlumX metric, PlumX index. We have mentioned H index, we have mentioned impact factor, for defined forms of impact factor, site score, SJIR, SNIP. So one thing I forgot to mention is PlumX index. PlumX index takes into account the citations which are there on social networking platforms, say on Wikipedia, say on Facebook, say on Twitter. So whenever you are getting cited on these platforms, this is the index which would measure your impact on these social media platforms. If you want to assess an author comprehensively in terms of its scholarly output as well as in terms of its social networking output, then you can club his H index, as well as you can always have a look at its PlumX metric, PLUM and then capital X. This is social networking metric.
Fine, let us take the last query by Sachin from Central University. He asked if Howard style has been used, but I would like to change with APA. Can we change the same?
Yes. You can switch over to any style you want to switch over. The moment you will click to that style window, it would the drop down menu would appear, and all the styles would be listed over there alphabetically. You select whichever you want to select. If you are presently working with Harvard, you just select APA, American Psychological Association 7th edition style. It would get and you don't have to type anything. You just select, and your bibliography will automatically get transformed into that style.
Okay, I guess with this, let's come to the end of the session. Well, there are a few more questions. One question came from Vasudev Joshi, and he asked, how can plagiarism affect the core interest of research? And would taking some relevant points in the hypothesis be considered as plagiarism?
See, it is very hard to comment on it, but the basic fundamental thing which you should remember is that whenever you are taking something from any resource, it is always, always advisable to give acknowledgement to that reference. In that case, you will not fall into the ambit of plagiarism, and you will not be counted as an academic misconduct category. And secondly, you, like you are saying, can I include that in my hypothesis? Actually, research is something new. You are giving a new dimension to it. So it's always advisable to formulate your hypothesis with a new dimension. You may take an idea from the hypothesis being framed by others, but since you are looking at the other aspect of that area, it is always advisable to use it in your own words and with a new aspect.
Okay, one more important question from Isleen Kaur. She wanted to know, is research paper and thesis, in research paper and thesis, we give reference or bibliography, as you have mentioned. What is the difference between two?
I did mention it in my last session also. I'm happy to mention it again this session also. See, whenever we are using, say I'm using for producing a document, I'm using 20 documents. I'm consulting, referring to 20 documents, and on the basis of those 20 documents, I am producing and adding on to my content. So I will be citing, so from this document, as per this document, this aspect of study has been studied like this. Okay. So, and on the end of it, I will be producing the complete bibliographic details, address of those documents at the end. They are references. But apart from these 20 references, if I'll be using other related references of other related literature also. Say 20 I have used in my article. Okay, let me understand. Please make me try to understand me. I have used 20 documents. These 20 I have given in my reference list. But apart from this 20, I want to include 20 more. Though I have not read them, I have not included them in my article. I have not cited them in my article, but I know they are also dealing with the same topic. So I am just suggesting my authors to you go to these 20. So in that case, I would not be naming my list of references as with the name references. I would name that as bibliography. Bibliography. It is its coverage is more. I hope I am able to make it clarify.
So let us come to the end of the
Okay, there is a question I'm able to see. Someone is asking, should we give references or bibliography? It's entirely up to you. It's up to you. There is no parameter that if you are giving references, somebody would judge, oh, she has just given references, not giving any other information apart from the ones she has used. Never mind. You just give references, and if bibliography, if you want to give, there is no such judging criteria. Give what you want to give, it's entirely up to you. But if you have got some good reports and you have not referred to them, but you want them to include, so it's always better to include for your readers. You give a bibliography. Bibliography on any day is more comprehensive.
Okay, I guess with this, let's come to the end of the session, and. I would like to take this opportunity to thank our principal, sir, Dr. Anil Sardana, who actually had to leave because of a meeting in the university, Dr. Kalpana Gupta, Dr. Poonam Sharma, who is the coordinator with us, of course, Dr. Pujanand Gulati, and our dear colleague. Thank you all for encouraging us to conduct the second webinar. The series of the webinar is decided on the basis of the feedback received from you all. So we understand the importance of research, and definitely for the same, we need to build a strong foundation. I hope we are able to serve the purpose, and with this, we come to the end of the session. Thank you all. That's it.
So we would like to thank Pooja ma'am for such an insightful and enlightening session. Now, before we end